So if you don't know who I am, my name is Brian Penny. I am a freelance writer and a whistleblower. I'm currently 36 as I'm making this video, but I've been doing this since I was 30. So 2011 is when I kind of got into the whistleblowing trade, the freelance trade, working from home, doing all this kind of stuff. I've learned a bit about how to do it. I've been working online, remotely, with different clients for the last 6 years, in two different aspects. I've been working both as a freelance journalist. You'll see my articles published in Forbes, Fast Company, Huffington Post. They're editorials. And I've got some stuff with Main Street, with Cannabis Now, High Times. There's a bunch of places now. Cracked, I'm currently working on. Paste Magazine, I've been recently published in. Those are under my own name. I also work as a ghostwriter in marketing, and I have several clients that I do that for, where I write a lot of the stuff that you've read in the New York Times, New York Post, Washington Post, Wired, Cracked, a lot of these places, Forbes. It's been ghostwritten by people like me. So I basically just wanted to explain some of the things that I've done over the years to make money, some things I've tried successfully, some things I've not done very well, some things it's more my problem, I guess, but some of them I don't really like the site, and I'll do my best to kind of differentiate those for you. Everybody wants to make money online. I see a lot of things on Facebook. There's constant things on Facebook where there's like social media marketing is the new thing right now, network marketing. And they would say, you'll make, you know, join my whatever system, pay for my system, buy my book, watch my videos, come to my seminar, do whatever, and you'll learn how to make $30,000 in 30 days. You can make $100,000 a year doing this or whatever. These are fantasies at best. They're promising overnight success, and most of these people have not achieved those things. If I was making those numbers of, you know, six digits a year, or $50,000 and or $30,000 in 30 days, that I wouldn't be wasting my time doing what I'm doing right now. I'm doing what I'm doing because I'm making freaking $20,000 at best on a good year. I do get a little bit more up and down, but it goes into the business. Everything that I make, I spend on the business, on getting everything going. Running a business from home is really difficult. There's a lot of things. You don't get health insurance, you don't have 401k, you don't get company matching of anything, you don't get sick days, you don't get holidays, you don't get double pay, any of this stuff. It's all just working for free. I have two kind of facets too of what I work in besides the media marketing. That's just my, you know, paid work that all fits into one thing of my paid work that I do. That's things that I do to earn a living, survive, make money, put dinner on my plate, things like that. Then there's also the free work that I put in, and that is work that I do for myself, for my blog, for self-promotion, things like that, that I don't get anything for. I do a ton of that. It's shadow work in a way, but it's necessary because when you're working for yourself, when you're a freelancer, you have no support. You have no accounting department, no HR, no managers, no anybody. You make all the decisions, you carry them all out, you do everything. If you don't do it, it doesn't get done. So some of the ways that I have monetized my blog, basically, I've monetized my writing, which is a per article thing. Sometimes, you know, paid a flat rate per article, sometimes paid per word, things like that, sometimes paid by traffic. I try to avoid those. But that's one aspect. And then I also have affiliate marketing and ads that come through. And I'm also, recently, I started doing a lot of product reviews, so I've got a lot of new products in from a lot of different places. Behind me, if you can't really see much, is a closet full of some of it. Up at the top is the whiskey collection. That's kind of impressive. I've gotten guitars, I've gotten tons of things. Camera, I'm actually filming this on it, that I had to pay for though, unfortunately. But the microphones are free and all sorts of other stuff. So I've been turning around and selling a lot of that stuff to, you know, help supplement my income and survive during some of the down times where I'm not getting work from other things. I have a lot of recurring clients. A lot of work is, you know, it's not I don't advertise a lot of my services. LinkedIn shows like maybe a quarter of what I've actually done. I got just so annoying. Oh, it's so annoying having to update LinkedIn, and I just hate all the emails and everything to do with it. Hold on, my cat's chasing something crazy. So eBay has been one of the things I've been doing a lot of. Craigslist, I tried for a little while. The reason I like eBay more than Craigslist is because it's so much easier. I had a friend explain it to me, and he's exactly right, that you just get people who will just flake on you, give you all sorts of lowball offers all over Craigslist. It happens a little bit on eBay, but it's not so bad. But, you know, it's such a pain to sell things through Facebook groups, things like that. But when you're selling stuff on eBay, it's quick. You can have the post office bring you the boxes for free, then they'll pick them up after you put everything in and print the label and everything. Like, it's a very low cost way to get a business running. So I've been able to do that, running that business from home. I've talked to so basically there's three different ways people, creative types, that usually will do this work from home thing in this new era that we're in. There's the writers, the content creators. There's the designers, who are the graphics people, and then there's the developers, who are the tech people. And they're all creative artists, the new age, the modern era, 21st century creative artists. And we basically have whatever, it all comes eventually down from which brand is paying us. Sometimes it's the marketing agency, sometimes it's the media, sometimes it's the brands themselves. And right now the FTC is having a big thing about whether, you know, a lot of these social influencers, brand ambassadors, things like that need to, you know, say that they are who they are. Like, they're a true brand ambassador. I've talked to some of these, they're called booth babes. They're the models that they hire to look pretty and, you know, be the marketing reps during, you know, big festivals and trade shows and things. And they basically are explaining that sorry, I lost my train of thought. I'm stoned. I'm going to edit a lot of this stuff out. But they were saying that when, like, to call yourself a brand ambassador, you have got to live, breathe, eat, sleep, poop this fucking brand. Like, they dress you up. They put you in everything, dress you to the nines. You'll see it at E3. Check it out. They do crazy, insane brand ambassador stuff. CES is a huge festival. They do it. When someone's a brand ambassador, it's like being a NASCAR racer. You know, there's so much obvious, this is an ad, this is a commercial, you must know this. And there are social influencers now that call themselves brand ambassadors. They don't know what else to call themselves because they look up, you know, content marketing, social media marketing, SEO, things like this, digital marketing online, modern marketing, and nobody really knows. So there are people that know, but it's so new that there's a lot of snake oil salesmen. And so there's people that don't know really what to call themselves. In order to get a lot of this stuff, that's what the Cracked article is actually going to be about, is how I leverage the media outlets I have to get a platform, to get brands to send me things, to become a tastemaker, is by basically they all want, you know, the links in there. They can't do it because they don't accept marketing. I'm not marketing when I'm doing it. I'm doing it as a legitimate freelance journalist. I'm doing a review. I'm doing a list of something that, some type of including this product into this article and doing an article, a story around it, which it does get into a gray area. I've seen some crazy things in doing this over the years, but it's how the world works right now. The way the creative economy is going is that freelancers are working from home. There's plenty of us. There's a few of my neighbors that are doing the same thing, that, you know, we figure out the same place, find a cheap place to live, and, you know, post up and work and live from home. I have a studio at home. And some are designers, some are, you know, developers and all sorts of things. This entrepreneurial spirit, it definitely takes, you know, some motivation. You have to, one of the greatest teachers of my life was a manager that I had at Bank of America, who she basically always explained to me that she ran her department like a small business, and that's how she just does it. And I, you know, I try to run my, what I do as a small business. My work from home, my freelance gig, that's everything that I do. I have business cards. Let me grab them. I'll tell you right now, I purposely picked the worst possible font that you can use for these things, the Comic Sans, because I think Comic Sans is hilarious, but people do not. But yeah, you gotta have these business cards. You've gotta go to these places. Go to any events, go to whatever it is that you want to write about. You have to be there, you have to go there. You have to, like, if you want to be a war reporter, you can't just talk about it. You got to go there, you know, be a war journalist, go experience what they're doing and watch and learn and interview, talk to these people like Vice does on HBO, like everybody's been doing since Vietnam. If you want to be like a video game reviewer, journalist, there you can sit at home and play video games, but eventually you're going to have to go to these tournaments, go to the, you know, Nintendo Championships, go to the League of Legends Championships, go to PAX, any of them, East, West, South, they're making them all over the place. Go to E3, go to CES, learn about everything, virtual reality. Those festivals are popular all over the place. Even cannabis, there's so many cannabis, regional cannabis events that you just have to go. You have to go talk to these people, meet them face to face, and having a business card is how you do that. And when you've got everything up on your blog, you're able to have your portfolio to show them what you can do. They'll talk to you. They'll talk to you anyways, but they'll show you what they're doing. They'll give you whatever it is you need. Take video, take pictures with you. They'll talk to you, give you information about what their company's doing. That's how you learn about what's going on without having to Google it. Anybody can Google it. I can Google something. You telling me something that I can Google is not helpful. Following the news cycle, you can't do it. You have to create your own news cycle. You have to create your own niche. You have to figure out your own way. And that is how I've managed to do it. It's hard. I can tell you, doing what you love. I started writing because I loved it. I knew that it was something that I could make money off of, and I could do it for a living. And I there's times where I hate it. I still do. I hate sometimes where I have to do an assignment. I'm doing anything else but the one thing that I should be doing. But there's times, you know, I push through. I always push through as often as possible. I've, you know, had a few failures, but mostly hits. I've had a lot of really good, really good times, really good things. I get asked a lot when I tell people that I'm a writer that, you know, how do you get published? How do you do something like that? It's easy. It's very easy. It's not easy to, obviously anybody would do it, but it is a simple process. You go contact the people, you have something relevant to say. That's the hard part. You get that out and you put it in the format that they need. You ask them what they like. There are, you know, some of the clients, long-term clients I've worked for are SEO and content marketing agencies, and some of them have databases of, you know, what every editor likes at every media outlet or every major blog that has any kind of an audience worth pitching to. I even get pitches for my own blog because I'm high enough up on some of the SEM rush things. There's a lot, analytics plays a huge part in it. You have to constantly watch your analytics. I'm constantly watching Google Analytics, Google AdSense, looking through Google AdWords for research. I don't buy any ads. Everything I have is organic, but I still use those keyword search tools to figure out what people are, you know, looking at, what's trending, things like that. There's Amazon affiliates, the Rakuten link share, there's several of them. Then there's also the PayPal, Venmo, and all these payment services. You've got to monitor and you've got to check everything to make sure everything's matching up with what it needs to. YouTube has its own set of ads that still integrates with analytics, but it's still a little different. WordPress has its own. But keep up on all these. See how, you know, what you think that is working. See if it really is working. Once you're done writing an article, an average of 1,000-word article, let's say, will take me probably 4,000 to 10,000 words of writing emails and things like this back and forth, contracts, filling those out, filling out the paperwork to get everything set up to have that article published when I'm publishing anywhere off my site, and negotiating all the terms, the payment, the, you know, whether or not I can use it, when I can use it, after it's theirs, if I sell them the content. But then afterwards, there's also a ton of hours that's, you know, sometimes it's formatting, sometimes it's getting pictures. There's, you know, there's social media that you do. There's all sorts of promotions. You got to make sure, I mean, everything that I publish, I promote on everything I can. I promote it on LinkedIn, Tumblr, Pinterest, Twitter, Facebook, Pocket, I think is what that thing was called. Some random little media thing. Reddit, usually, I'll stumble upon. Different Facebook groups, too. My own Facebook page, and then different Facebook groups I'll post it in when it's relevant and it's not spammy. Then I'll go through and search. Sometimes I don't do this for every post anymore, but I'll go through and search for relevant like articles about things or websites about things, forums, discussions that I can, you know, put those links in to build that web out. And then you go through and, you know, as long as you're categorizing, tagging everything right the right way, you've got everything set up, it's going to all funnel through and it all, you know, helps you in the long run. Everywhere that you get published at, they most often they will give you a link back to your website on your profile and on their page, so that helps you out a lot too. And then once you can, you know, just like you see all those products and say, as seen on TV or whatever, as seen on Oprah's favorite things or all those things, Shark Tank, it adds a little value. More people see it, it's a bigger platform. So you get a bigger platform, you get, you know, wider exposure, and then you're able to, you know, you're a better product. You can start marketing yourself to better people that pay more, that bigger companies that might have bigger contracts. Right now, with the way that everything's kind of working is that it used to be where the freelance economy was hired by agencies, and then the agencies were, you know, contracting work out to the brands, and that still happens a lot. But there's a lot of brands that are increasingly finding, you know, freelancers on their own, which is, again, why you need to go out to all these things and meet these people so that they know who you are and what you do. How you present yourself makes a big difference. You can't be one of those people. I mean, this video is going to get like 10 fucking views by the time I post it. By the like end of this year, it might be in triple digits. But like, I still have some pull because I have some. I've been being cracked and wired places like that. I've been in Huffington Post, Forbes, High Times, Fast Company, all these places. So I have a little bit of I guess buzz that I could go over the years. As long as I keep this going and I can do it. Then it maintains itself. Well, my residual income, I guess, is my retirement, is the affiliate ads, which is me basically doing enough videos, enough pictures, enough things, going to enough events, enough blogs, putting enough guest posts together that I get some residual traffic in, so I can start building it up enough to where I can just pay my bills entirely and live off of just my blog alone without having to do all the other work for everybody else. But right now, that's not where I'm at, and you know, it's been 6 years, so, you know, when they say 30,000 in 30 days, it's ridiculous. There was a travel writer, I remember, I went off on her because she was trying to promote herself as being able to, like, you know, six-digit travel writing income, and I looked at her portfolio, and there's no way, like, her total portfolio for the entire, like, 6 years she had been writing, there's no way she had made $100,000, like, total, maybe total, but, like, if they counted all of her expenses and everything, because I'm sure they were paying for some of her trips, and she was putting photos and stuff, but she had to do a lot of things to do that. It wasn't $100,000, it wasn't a true $100,000 income, and you know, that's why she was trying to sell that. And when you looked her up on SEMrush, her website, you know, you see her value versus mine, it was nothing. It was, she was just another snake oil salesman trying to sell people on how to do something that she can't do. It's a lot like those, you know, Herbalife type things, and yeah, pyramids. There's the other one, the Herbalife competitor, but I won't say the name because I know people that work for them and they get annoyed when I do it. LuLaRoe is another one, but they also hate me. But yeah, it's another one of those people who are just high pressure sales and it sucks for them. But I guess that would be the biggest things I would say to watch out for when you're working as a freelancer is to make sure that you're valuing yourself, valuing your time. I don't work for less than certain minimums. There's some, I'll lower it for, you know, friends and things like that or certain things, but if, you know, it's an absolute no. There's too much work involved, and there's a lot of times where people want too much other things that aren't really included. It takes forever just to record, like, this 20-minute video is going to take me like 3 hours to actually go through and fucking fix to post and upload to YouTube, and it just gets insane. When you have to keep changing different things, changing everything. If I had to re-record this because I had, you know, the focus was off, or because I just don't like the lighting, I'm screwed. That's a waste of my time. And you just don't waste your time. Don't let people, you know, don't get too far into work before somebody pays you. Let them go net 30 if they have to, which is 30 days after. But don't let them go too many months. You know, just keep reminding them for as friendly as possible. Then after a while, just stop working. Just don't do anything. Once you, sorry, like be as friendly as possible. Don't let them go too far. But like eventually, it's just, hey, we got to cut this off. You don't pay, you got to pay me. And still, just I don't work with some people because they were too much of a pain in the ass to work with to get paid by. And some of them I can just tell from the beginning that they're going to be too much of a pain in the ass. It's just money is a big thing, and I don't want to waste it. And time is a big thing; I don't want to waste it. So it's one of those things where, you know, when you start working for yourself, you start to learn how to value other people's time. I value like the Uber drivers a lot more than I ever would have before. It's, you know, my neighbor and I, we talk a lot. I talk a lot with a lot of people who work from home. There's a lot of women that work from home, by the way. So you are missing out on a lot of people that you do not meet in life because they work from home, and they're awesome people to know, and they all like me, I like them, and we understand the trials and tribulations of, you know, you can have 3 months of up really high revenue and it can just drop, and you've got to be prepared for those things so that you can keep paying everything normal like everybody else. You've got to force yourself to, you know, I've been woken up to an alarm clock in, you know, 6 years. I did 60 days in Tent City jail where they were like waking me up with a fucking flashlight in my face at 4 a.m. But like other than that, I have woken up whenever I wanted to. I think maybe like one or two times as a special occasion for somebody I had an alarm, but other than that, I just woke up with whatever my body lets me. And it's the biggest, that alone is the lifestyle change that I needed, that I will always hold on to this lifestyle for, is because I am in control of my time, I'm in control of my life and my decisions. And I know that there's a lot of comfort that I had when I was working at the banks and corporate America, and I just don't have that anymore. But, you know, I do learn to kind of work and adapt to what the situation is, which is, you know, the human spirit anyways. So if you do want to start working from home, if you want to start a website, a blog, any of this stuff, I would just say start, go do it. It's really easy. Go to WordPress.com, Blogspot.com, Zoomla.com, one of them. Sign up and they will walk you through the process. It's just like building a Facebook page. It's just like building a MySpace page, an Instagram profile, a Twitter profile, all this crap you already have done a million times over and over and over and over and over and over again. It's easier than filing your taxes. Go just pick a couple of pictures, throw it up there, pick whatever it is, no matter what type, what you're into, pick it out. There's free stuff, so much free stuff you can get. You can spend $30 and get a bunch of even better shit. I spend like $100 a year for all of the stuff that I have for my hosting, but I have, you know, I've been doing it long enough that I do have some, I basically have about 15 to 20,000 viewers consistently going through my blog, but I've got, you know, enough going through my YouTube channels and my social media and everything else that it's all growing. And it's a lot easier than you think it would be, because the numbers for like a local newspaper back in the day, like the Sierra Vista Herald, I grew up in Sierra Vista, Arizona, and I used to be a paper boy for the Sierra Vista Herald. It was a town of like 45,000 people, I want to say, at the time. And so there was maybe 10,000 at most subscribers to their newspaper. So I have a bigger audience than that newspaper I used to deliver for back in the day, a small town newspaper. And it's cool to know that, but that's not where I, you know, I need to get a little higher than that, but it is cool to know that that's, you know, I'm still doing better than the actual paper is. If you look at Sierra Vista Herald, they have like the Wall Street Journal, like a paywall where if you want to finish reading the story, you got to pay. Like, what is some small town newspaper going to tell me that I can't read on anywhere online? You have nothing exclusive that I can't get, except for maybe a wedding or funeral announcement. But, yeah, so it's that's how you get started, and after that, just fill it with content. That's the hard part. Fill it with as much content as possible. Get it solid, formatted, and get all the links in for your affiliate stuff, and just keep doing it over and over and over. The more you do it, the more subjects you tackle, the more refined you get at it, the better you get at it, the more stuff you have, the wider of a net you have. Wikipedia is the biggest, you know, website, and we all see it at the top of the search results because no matter what you search, they have an opinion on it. Find an opinion on everything that you possibly can, as many things as possible, and you will get that traffic eventually. You'll be one of those people, and you can start making money online. I basically I would say by the time I'm 40, I'm supposed to be, well, it's 4 years from now, I should be at $50,000 a year. That's my goal to get up to. So we'll see if I'm there by 2020 or 2017 right now. It's 2017. Did I say 16 earlier? I don't fucking know. I'm probably not gonna edit this, maybe. Maybe all these little stupid asides are gonna like get this thing where it needs to go. But yeah, that's all that I've got on that one. Also, the shirt I'm wearing from Bookman's, one of my favorite shirts, by the way. It's the censorship, the assassination of an idea. So don't ever let anyone censor you when you're doing any kind of content online for yourself. That's why every artist is trying to get their own labels, independent everything, so that they don't have to pay it to all these other people that don't get censored. And, you know, that's the fight for everybody. It's a struggle for everybody. It's not just musicians. Those people are just, you know, they're going through the same thing everyone else is, trying to keep hold of our own creations. But, yeah, so if you want to, if there's anything I didn't answer, and want to know anything else, just let me know. Leave some comments, do whatever, follow me, I don't give a fuck. Find me somewhere else. Usually versatile or thoughtforyourpenny.com. Find me on there. Other than that, I will catch you later and have a great one.